Take up thy cross and follow me. I heard my master say, I gave my life to ransom thee. Surrender your all today. Christ who loves me so, wherever he leads, I'll go. He drew me closer to his side. I saw his will. I now abide. Wherever he leads, I'll go. Wherever he leads, I'll go. Wherever he leads, I'll go. I'll follow my Christ who loves me so, wherever he leads, I'll go.
Once again to our Wednesday night Bible study from Portrush Baptist Church. Thank you so much for joining with us. We welcome you in the Lord's name, and we trust that we have a blessed time together around God's word this evening. But before we start, let's just still our hearts and bring our time before the Lord in prayer. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we bow before thee this evening in the Savior's name, thanking thee and praising thee for thy good hand upon us during today. We thank thee for our mercy that thou hast bestowed upon us. We thank thee, our Father, for thy goodness and thy grace that has followed us every step of the way. We come to thee this evening, our Father God, to ask again for thy help as we study thy word. We thank thee for it. We thank thee that it's a light and a lamp unto our feet and path. And Father, we pray today that we would see very clearly its direction. And Father, see very clearly where it leads us. And Father, we just pray if there be some watching in this evening who are not saved, that you would save them. And Father, we just look to thee right now just to help us, just in our study, and keep our minds focused on thee, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, folks, you know that we're looking at the carpenter's tools. We're looking at the disciples. And I want to take you to Matthew chapter 26 tonight. Matthew chapter 26 this evening and verse 17 down through to verse 25. Let's hear the word of God together. Now, the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus and saying unto him, where wilt thou that we prepare for thee to eat the Passover? And he said, go into the city to such a man and say unto him, the master saith, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples. And the disciples did as Jesus had appointed them, and they made ready the Passover. Now when the evening was come, he sat down with the 12, and as they did eat, he said, verily I say unto you that one of you shall betray me. And they were exceedingly sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? And he answered and said, he that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. The Son of Man goeth, as it is written of him, but woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born. Then Judas, which betrayed him, answered and said, Master, is it I? And he said unto him, thou hast said. Amen. And we know that God again will bless the public reading of his own inspired, precious, holy, infallible word. We're coming this evening to study the most notorious and reviled and hated man in the Bible, Judas Iscariot. His name is synonymous with betrayal of the most bitterest and sordid kind. He is that unforgettable figure of human history. He's the man who betrayed the Lord with a kiss, the most insidious of all evil acts. And he stands as a reminder as to the depths to which the human heart can sink. As I thought about him and considered him, I wondered, well, should we even be looking at him? Should we even be studying this man? For he was never one of the Lord's disciples. He was always the devil's disciple, never the Lord's. He had spent those 3 years of the Lord's earthly ministry, walking beside the Savior, the Son of God. And yet, while the other 11 disciples were growing in grace, his black heart was getting harder and harder and more demonic in nature. And so I wondered, should I even be looking at him this evening? But I felt that to be true to the study, we had to include him. For there's such mystery that surrounds him, so many questions asked about him, that I believe that it's right for us just to take this evening to consider him. This is a hard study for a preacher. Because as a preacher, we're always looking to get the application, to edify the believers, to build them up in their most holy faith, to encourage them. And when you look at this character, it's hard to find those applications. It's hard to find that encouragement. So this study, it may take on a different approach. But I hope and pray that as we go through this man, as we examine him, there will be some measure of good and application and encouragement that we can take from it. But let's see how it goes. So let's get started. The name Judas Iscariot, it appears last on every list of the disciples, except in Acts chapter 1, where it doesn't appear at all. And every time Judas is spoken of, he is always referred to as the betrayer, the one who betrays the Lord. And as we look at him this evening, I want you to see, first of all, his heritage. I want you to see his heritage. In John chapter 6 and in verses 70 and 71, we read these words. Jesus answered them, have not I chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil? He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. And we're told here in John chapter 6 and verse 71 that Judas's father was named Simon. But I want to say, that's all we know of his background. We don't know anything else about his background. Can I just lay something out there? And you may disagree with me. I have a funny feeling that when Antichrist comes, now you and me as believers will be home in glory. But when the Antichrist takes up his power here on earth, there's going to be very little known of his background. I think there'll be very little known of where he comes from or where he belongs to. But that's just my thinking. I might be wrong. But concerning Judas, and while we don't know an awful lot about him, or don't know really anything about his background, I think, if I can put it to you, I think that Judas came from a family that held high religious hopes for their son. You see, the name Judas is from the Hebrew Judah, which means Jehovah shall be praised. And I'm sure that when his parents named him, their hearts soared with a deep spiritual and godly expectation concerning him. They wanted this boy to grow up and to be a man of God. His last name, Iscariot, well, it refers to where he came from, a small town called Keroth, just outside to the south of Judah. And he comes across, if you look at him, he comes across as kind of an isolated figure. You see, he's the only one of the 12 who didn't come from Galilee. The rest of the disciples were either brothers or friends, or they worked together. But Judas seems to be a bit of an outsider, a bit of a loner. And perhaps this is what made his heart so susceptible to the cunning enticements of the devil. He was a fit vessel for the devil to use, always being in the shadow, always being in the background. Could I say just a wee word of warning to believers? And I'm not saying the devil's going to take you over, but there's always a danger of not being with God's people. And I said that in our study last week as well. But there's a danger of not being with God's people. And we're living in days today. And I know I've said this last week, but I'm going to say it again. Where the temptation is, with everything that's on YouTube, that you just sit in your house when the churches are opened up again and when we can get back to fellowship again. And you don't come to the fellowship because it's easier just to watch YouTube. That's not biblical. That's not God's will. And there's a danger in that because a lot of stuff can find a resting place in your heart that shouldn't be in your heart when you separate yourself from God's people. But for Judas, being in the shadows, being in the background, it gave him the perfect cover to conceive his plan of betrayal. Now, beloved, if there's an application here, it might be this. The enemies of the cross can be ordinary men and women. They don't have to be high flyers. They don't have to be politicians. They don't have to be presidents and kings and all the rest. They can just be ordinary people. People that can blend into the background where they're barely seen. For when the Lord said that one of the disciples would betray him, nobody pointed the finger at Judas. And something else. They can live in the fellowship of God's people. What does Jude say in Jude 1 and 4? For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. I tell you, beloved, and I'm speaking to our folk in Portrush Baptist here, we need to plead for the Lord to put a hedge of the blood about our fellowship in these days. For I believe that there are days coming when the enemies of the cross will be sitting amongst us with nothing but evil on their mind and in their heart. But that was just a wee thought there about his heritage. But I want you to see, secondly, his honor. The time that Judas lived in was one of great expectation for the return of the Messiah. You see, Rome had conquered the world, as it were. They were the world's superpower, and they had driven their heel hard into the neck of Israel. And Israel, the Jew, was a second-class citizen, even in their own land. And of course, they're still considered second-class citizens in the world today. And they were being taxed by the Roman government to within an inch of their life. Politically, they had a puppet government headed by Herod the king, who was a king in name only. And there was no leader emergent for the people of Israel, like there was in the Old Testament with the prophets. There was no man coming to the fore to stand in the gap for God, for the people. There was no hope of restoration to their Old Testament glory. And so the cry was going up for the Messiah to return to deliver his people. And of course, the Jews, as they still are today, are looking for a political military leader, one who would drive out the enemy, one who would set up the throne of David again. And so when the Lord appears upon the world stage, and the Lord comes not being constrained by the laws of nature, not being controlled by the dictates of Rome, one, it seemed, was untouchable by the invading powers of Rome, that political monster of Rome, couldn't seem to get a grasp upon him. One who spoke of the kingdom of God that was to come, that would be eternal, who spoke as never man had spoken before, whom God himself had declared as his son, in whom he was well pleased. And I'm sure that Judas thought, this is the Messiah. And he had listened to the sermons. He had witnessed the miracles. He had saw the Lord's love for the people. Here's the one. Oh, I'm sure Judas thought to himself, here's the one who's going to storm the strongholds of the enemy. Here's the one who's going to set us free. You see, I believe that Judas was a militant nationalist who believed that Jesus was going to overthrow the evil rule of Rome through the blood of the Romans. He was going to slaughter them. But instead, God was going to overthrow the power of Satan by the blood of the Lamb. And as the other 11 had done, he left what it was doing to follow him, and even to stay with him when the less devoted disciples fell away in John chapter 6. But what an honor was bestowed upon Judas, that he could walk with Jesus, to have his name upon the lips of the Savior, to have borne witness of his love and his power. To the other disciples, even though sometimes they were misunderstood, this was a wondrous thing, that their lives were being changed, their souls were racing with a new spiritual vigor, their minds were capturing the substance that was only spoken of in the shadows of the Old Testament. Their natures, their person, their being, their lives were being formed and sculptured by the hands of the one who flung the stars into space. But for Judas, there was no such spiritual awakening. His motives were selfish. His mind set upon one desire, his heart filled with hatred, his life defigured by demonic intent. And he occupies the shadows of hell. Oh, he could see the power that Jesus wielded, but he wanted it for himself. He wanted to be in the driving seat. He wanted to be the one who would be steering the course of the Lord's ministry. I tell you, that is a mark of the devil. My, if you went to the book of Isaiah 14, we know it so well. In verse 12, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the side of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. And Judas was shown all the marks of demonic control. Yes, even though when it was an easy thing to do, he followed on. He followed the Lord, even when it wasn't easy. But it wasn't out of love for the Savior. It was out of the plans of perdition that were now formulating in his darkened heart. Oh, there's, you can see here, if you think about it, there's a great tension between the divine sovereignty of God and the human responsibility of man. Yes, the rest of the disciples had chosen Jesus, but he had chosen them first. John 15, verse 16, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you. And Judas was chosen to follow the Lord. He had chosen to follow the Lord. And yet he too had been chosen by the Lord, not for redemption, but for betrayal in fulfillment to the Old Testament prophecy of Psalm 41 and 9. Yea, mine own familiar friend in whom I trusted, which did eat of my bread, hath lifted up his heel against me. And the Lord refers to that again in John chapter 13 and verse 18. And yet, dear friends, the Lord didn't coerce Judas into any of his evil acts. He didn't force him into it. Indeed, as we will see just in a wee minute or two, the Lord gave him every opportunity to come clean and repent and turn away from the course he had embarked upon. Now, what Jesus did, or what Judas did, sorry, he did of his own free will. Indeed, the Lord says that he would bear the guilt of his deeds throughout eternity. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 24, the Son of Man goeth as it is written of him. But woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had never been born. Beloved, there's no contradiction here. Judas did what he did out of his own evil heart, which God foreordained that he would do in accordance with his perfect will. And both the sovereignty of God and the responsibility of man are living together here in perfect harmony, and they'll have their meeting place at the throne of God, as Spurgeon says. But Judas was privy to such honor as to walk with the Lord, yet he was never drawn to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Judas had only one honor in view, one goal in view, and that was his own. Beloved, I know that there's no Judases in the fellowships. I'm not talking to any. I don't think anyway. I hope I'm not. But the danger is that we forget, or we start to take for granted this priceless and wondrous and glorious honor that has been bestowed upon us through the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we should now be called the children of God, to walk in communion with the Lord Jesus Christ, to know that in glory our names are upon his lips, for he is our great high priest, that we forget what an honor it is to be in this fellowship. And I'm speaking to Portrush Baptist folk, to be in our wee fellowship in Portrush Baptist with our brothers and our sisters, and to know that Jesus is in the midst of us. That's a glorious thing. That's a wondrous thing. Oh, we've looked at his heritage. I think his family had great religious expectations about him. We've looked at his honor. He got to walk with the Lord. But I want you to see, thirdly, his hunger. And for that, we have to go to John chapter 12. John chapter 12 and verses 1 to 8. Let's hear God's word. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead. There they made him a supper. And Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then saith one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bare what was put therein. Then said Jesus, let her alone. Against the day of my burial hath she kept this. For the poor always ye have with you, but me ye have not always. Judas had a hunger for power and possessions that was growing with insatiable speed. And while the rest of the disciples were rising to the challenge of godliness, their hearts beginning to grasp the great truths of redemption, Judas was growing more and more hard of heart, disillusioned by the Lord's meekness, his reluctance to throw down the gauntlet, as it were, to Rome. And we can see his growing demonic possession in the passage of Scripture that records his nature. The Lord, even in John chapter 6 and verse 7, he calls him a devil. It says there, Jesus answered them, have not I chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil? And this passage that we have read, it just speaks of that old nature coming through there. There's a devilish hunger that is now gushing to the forefront of Judas's life. The Lord is about to enter Jerusalem for the last time amidst the hosannas. Blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord, and there would be great celebration. And yet it was to the cross that the Lord was coming to. It was the cross that was looming before him, and the great weight of humanity's sin is beginning to rest heavily upon his sinless heart. But before this last trip, he returns to the home of his dear friends, Lazarus and Martha and Mary. And at the evening meal, Mary comes with a pound of ointment of spikenard, and she anoints the Lord's feet and wipes it with her hair. And in Judas, this self-fueled, hungry-hearted man could be silent no longer. And in verse 5, he says, "Why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor?" 300 pence was a year's wage. But John here, who's writing this gospel account, is now writing it 80 years later. And he can see now, as he's writing this, inspired by the Holy Spirit, what was hid from him that night. And he can see that Judas cared nothing for the poor, but that he wanted the money for himself because he was a thief. Remember who the devil is. The devil's a thief and a robber. And I want to tell you, Judas is just the carbon copy of him. John says in verse 6 that because he was a thief, and that he bore the bag and that which was put in it. Do you see that word bear? In the Greek, it has two meanings. It has the meaning to carry, and it also has the meaning to lift or to pilfer. And so Judas carried the bag, but he carried the bag so he could lift what he wanted out of it. What a hypocrite. We're even told in Matthew 26 and verse 8 that he even fooled the other disciples who sided with him. Beloved, be assured of this. And I want you to get this. Hypocrisy is a devilish attribute. It should have no place in the life of the believer. It is the birthplace of every evil and hellish intent. It has been the downfall of so many believers and so many churches down through the years. So many churches, as Matthew 23 says, the Lord says, are like whited sepulchres. They have all the appearance, but the glory's departed, because it's full of hypocrisy. If you look at the book of Proverbs, and the book of Proverbs chapter 6 and verses 16 to 19, it says here, we have the six things that God hates. It says, "These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him." Seven things: a proud look, a lying tongue, a hand that sheddeth innocent blood, an heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift into running to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord amongst brethren. God hates that. God hates that. And it has destroyed many believers and many churches. But listen to how the Lord speaks to him in verses 7. He says, "Let her alone. Against the day of my burial has she kept this. For the poor always ye have with you, but me ye have not always." And the Lord deals with him so gently. And yet this rebuke seems to push Judas over the edge. For listen to what Matthew records for us in Matthew 26, verses 14 to 16. "Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priests and said unto them, What will ye give me that I will deliver him in unto you? And they covenant with him for 30 pieces of silver. And from that time he sought opportunity to betray him." In Luke chapter 22 and verse 3, it says this, Then entered Satan into Judas. And that word "entered," it means to take possession of. And in John chapter 13 and verse 2, puts it like this, "And supper being ended," that's the Passover meal, it says, "the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him." And that word "put," it means to pour into. And Satan was now filling the heart of Judas with these desires of betrayal. What does Paul say to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 10? For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some covet after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. I want to tell you, there's so many believers today and they're nowhere with God because they love the money rather than they love the Lord. And Judas has now become the son of perdition, the son of utter destruction. Beloved, make sure that you're hungering after the right things. Make sure that you have a hunger for the things of God. Psalmist says in Psalm 27 and 4, one thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and 1 says this, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts. Listen, what are you looking for today? What are you chasing after? What are your ambitions? What are the hungers of your heart and your soul today, dear child of God? Are you hungering after the right things? Because if you're hungering after the wrong things, it'll be the ruin to your life and to your walk with God. Oh, his heritage, his honor, his hunger. But finally, I want you to see his harvest. And for the harvest, we have to go to John 13, just over the pace from where we were, and verses 21 to verse 30. It says there, when Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, verily, verily, I say unto you that one of you shall betray me. Then the disciples looked one on another, doubting of whom he spake. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. And Simon Peter therefore beckoned to him that he would ask him who it should be of whom he spake. He then, lying on Jesus' breast, said unto him, Lord, who is it? And Jesus answered, it is he to whom I will give a sop when I have dipped it. And when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. And after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then said Jesus unto him, what thou doest, do quickly. Now no man at the table knew of what intent he spake this unto him. For some of them thought because Judas had the bag that Jesus had said unto him, buy those things which we have need of against the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. He then, having received the sop, went immediately out, and it was night. Judas is allowed to carry his hell-driven intent into the Passover meal. And remember what happened at the Passover meal, how the Lord had stooped down to wash the feet of the disciples, even Judas. What an invitation to repent was given to Judas at that moment. And they take their seat at the table. Now, there's something incredible here that I want you to see. In those days in the Middle East, the guests inclined when they're eating on low couches and they rested on their left elbow. And it meant they were able to eat freely and drink freely with the right hand. Now, we can surmise that John was seated on the right-hand side of the Lord because he would have been leaning this here and his head would have been on the Savior's breast. But here's what I want you to see. The most favored place at the table was the left-hand side of the host. For the host would then be resting against your bosom, against your heart. And it seems that that is the place that the Lord had reserved for Judas. Oh, beloved, when I thought about this, I thought how near the Savior drew to this devil-possessed man and how gently and wordlessly his plea was for him to consider his deeds and how willing the Savior is that none should perish. But the meal is set. And then the Lord tells them that one will betray him. And they start asking the woman, who is it? Who could it be? Matthew 26 and 25 records that even Judas asked the question, I believe with a hissing hypocrisy, is it I? And Jesus answered, thou hast said. But oh, in John 13 and verse 2 tells us that the devil had now full control over Judas. It says, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot to betray him. And the door of grace is now closed. And mercy has given way to judgment. Hell is now moved with excitement at the coming of Judas Iscariot. And Jesus answers John's question. When Peter says to John, you ask the Lord. You ask the Lord who it is. And Peter says, who is it, Lord? And the Lord says, he it is to whom I shall give the sup when I have dipped it. And when he had dipped the sup, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Now let me explain just what that meant by the sup. At the Passover meal, there were, among other things, there were three particular pieces of food. There was what was called the cherosheth, which was a paste, and it was made from apples and dates and pomegranates and nuts. And it spoke of the clay, when it was all mixed together, it spoke of the clay that the Jews had to make the bricks with when they were in slavery in Egypt. And then there were what was called the bitter herbs, which reminded God's people of the bitterness of slavery. And finally, there was the unleavened bread, which spoke of their deliverance. Now, at one point in the Passover, some of the bitter herbs were placed between two pieces of unleavened bread, and they were dipped into the apple paste. And that was called the sup. Now, and this humbled me, beloved, for the host to personally make up a sup and hand it to a guest was a mark of great honor. And Jesus made up this sup. He dipped it, and he handed the sup to Judas. And he's again, the Lord's reaching out to Judas to repent, man, to consider what you're doing, to stop and change direction. Beloved, I want to say to you, and maybe you're watching this meeting tonight, and you're not saved. Every time you hear the gospel, every time you're told of your need to be saved, it is the Lord Jesus Christ dipping the sop and reaching it to you and telling you, man, repent of your sin before it's forever too late. Oh, but here's the sad thing. Satan had his heart. The demonic power of Satan owned his mind and his heart, and there was no place now found for repentance. But what I want you to see is this. The devil couldn't do a thing until the Lord gave him permission to do it. Listen to verse 27. And after the sup, Satan entered into him. Then said Jesus unto him, what thou doest, do quickly. The devil's now got full possession of him. Now some might disagree with me here. And that's okay. You can do that. That's fine. But I believe the Lord's not speaking to Judas here at this moment. When he says, what thou doest, do quickly. I think he's speaking to the devil. And the devil can't lay a finger on the Lord until the Lord gives him leave to do it. I want to tell you, Satan to Jesus must bow. And I want to tell you, beloved, this evening, Satan to Jesus still has to bow. We still have the victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to get that into our head and into our hearts and into our lives. But Satan to Jesus must bow. But Judas goes out, and we're told in verse 30 it was night. And I believe that when Judas left, it was then that the Lord instituted the Lord's Supper, because evil had to go. Scripture tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 27 to 32, that every man examine himself. And I think Judas had to go before the Lord could institute the Lord's Supper. And we know what happened next. This traitor, this coward, who has received nothing but grace and mercy and love from the hand of the Savior, comes to the Garden of Gethsemane with a detachment of soldiers in and around 600 and betrays the Savior with a kiss. And of course, the Lord doesn't try to hide himself. He steps out and asks him, whom seek ye? And Luke 22 and 48 says, but Jesus said unto him, Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss? In Matthew and Mark's account of this, they use a Greek word that's used for kiss, and it means to kiss repeatedly, to kiss over and over and over again. This act that was to speak of devotion and reverence and love, Judas has turned it into an act of repeated hatred. He had profaned the Passover. He had profaned the Lamb of God and the Son of God and now the place of prayer. And he had done it all with a kiss. And the plan that he had harbored for so long in his heart had now found its moment. And immediately he sees what he had done. If you go to Matthew chapter 27, Matthew chapter 27 and verses 1 to 10. It says, when the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. And then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? See thou to it. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. And the chief priest took the silver pieces and said, it is not lawful for to put them into the treasury because it is the price of blood. And they took counsel and bought with them the potter's field and buried to bury strangers in. Wherefore the field was called the field of blood unto this day. Immediately he sees what he has done. He goes back to the priests and he tells them, I've betrayed the innocent blood, and he begs them to take back the money. And when they wouldn't, because it was defiled, he throws it at their feet and he goes out and hangs himself. I tell you something, and if you're not saved, I want you to listen to me this evening. There was no place for repentance found for Judas. And I tell you that if you find yourself in a lost, Christless hell, you will find that hell is a place of remorse, eternal remorse, but it's not the place of repentance. There's a place where all hope is gone. Acts chapter 1. Verses 18, 19 gives us a wee bit more detail. It says, now this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity, and falling headlong, he burst asunder in the midst, and all his bowels gushed out. And it was known unto all that dwelt in Jerusalem, insomuch as that field is called in their proper tongue Armageddon, that is to say, the field of blood. There's no contradiction here with Matthew's account of the priest buying the field. The priest bought the field with the money which Judas had. And so it was a field bought with Judas's money and belonged to his heirs, if he had any. And it seems that he chose a tree that overhung a drop of jagged rocks below. And so when he tried to hang himself, the rope broke, or the branch broke, maybe after some time, and he fell and he was ripped open on the rocks. And it's interesting to note there's a place in Jerusalem that fits this description, and it's there that they say that Judas hung himself. But here's the harvest that he reaped. It says in Acts chapter 1 and verse 25, that he may take part of this ministry and apostleship. This is the choosing between Matthias and Barabbas. It says, for which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. And I want to tell you, folks, there's a place in hell where there's a man languishing tonight in indescribable torment, a man who betrayed the Lord with a kiss. And Jesus had said to him, it would have been better, it would have been good for that man if he'd never been born. And so the curtain falls on the life of Judas Iscariot. Some say that he will return as the Antichrist, who is called the son of perdition. I don't know if that's the case, if Judas is the Antichrist. But I know that when Antichrist comes, he will have the heart of Judas, for he will betray God's people just as Judas betrayed God's son. The lessons to be learned, beloved, here they are. Don't barter away our honor as the children of God for the passing things of this world. Don't let the temptations of this world dominate your mind, that we fail to see the joy that's set before us. Don't let your death be remembered for all the wrong reasons. Live for the Lord. Hunger after righteousness. Seek first the kingdom of God. What a privilege is ours to be called the sons of God. Amen. May God bless his word to our hearts and to our souls this evening. Let's just bow in a word of prayer. Father, We thank thee again for your goodness to us, your love, your mercy. We thank you for this study, a difficult study. Father, it is hard to do, but Father, we thank thee for the application you've brought to us. We pray, our Father God, that we would be a people who would be constantly hungering after thee. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. Father, we just pray that we would know what it is to be hungry after the right things, the things that glorify you and exalt you and bring praise and honor to you. Father, bless your people. Bless every home represented, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you, folks. Thank you so much for watching in again this evening. I really do appreciate it. And the Lord bless you till we meet again. Cheerio.
treasure of heaven.